Thunderdome Boxing Talk, Anthony here. All right, it's going to kind of be the prediction vid for Golovkin Brook. Not sure if it'll be my official prediction vid, but it's going to be what I put out there for now. And if anything, you know, my opinion changes due to, you know, what I see in the next couple weeks, then I'll make a new one. But... you know, just going off, you know, everything I understand so far and what I'm guessing will be kind of their fight night weights and everything like that. I feel fairly confident that, you know, I can make a prediction on this now and be fairly accurate. Along with the, you know, breakdown of the fight and how, you know, each guy's strong suits and, you know, what they need to do. And I also want to give a little bit of, like, historical precedence on, you know, welterweights versus middleweights. You know, you guys got to realize that when there was 8 divisions, any time a welterweight moved up, he was fighting a middleweight. You know, it's not like something that just should never be done. You know, guys jump up 2 divisions all the time. You know, like, and this is nothing like Canelo Khan. All right. Khan wasn't even one of the top 5 best welterweights. He never did anything at welterweight. Had been knocked out from 135, 140, was basically hurt by everybody he ever fought at 47. I mean, you know, that one, that's why everyone picked that fight so easy. And there's people out there picking Brook. A lot of people were picking Brook. You know, it's, and the odds of this fight are, you know, dude, I think Crawford Postol, everyone called that a 50-50 fight. I think the odds on that were the same or just either a little wider or a little closer. I don't know. Maybe, I think that was, what, 6-1 or 7-1? I can't remember. But, you know, on Tom Loeffler's Twitter, he just put out a tweet of all the fights that are on the books, like, penciled in already, and Golovkin Brook is the closest fight out of every scheduled fight there is, for, you know, from when he tweeted that, that's penciled in already for the rest of the damn year. Alright, so if you're gonna bitch about this fight, you know, come on. I mean, look at all the other fights out there. Jeez, I mean, this is literally, you know, on paper, it's the best fight we are getting for the rest of the year. You know, we'll have to see. Obviously, if Kovalev Ward gets made, them odds are going to be closer. But, you know, it ain't made yet, so we'll have to see. But, like, Sugar Ray Robinson, you know, shit. Greatest middleweight who ever lived, right? Come on, people say he is the greatest fighter who ever lived. A welterweight by the name of Carmen Basilio sure moved up and whooped his ass, you know. And Carmen Basilio is an all-time great fighter too, don't get me wrong. But, you know, if Carmen can move up and beat Sugar Ray Robinson, now what makes you think that Brook couldn't do something similar with Golovkin and beat him? You know, Basilio lost in the rematch. He also had a fucking, like, goddamn plum on his eye, but and still, you know, went the distance. I mean, you know, Hank Armstrong going up to fight Seferino Garcia. you know, which was a close fight. People feel that Hank got robbed because of the politics of him holding so many titles. It went the distance, you know. It sure went the distance. So, you know, if guys like Sugar Ray Robinson and Hank Armstrong are just so much better than Golovkin, why the fuck are they going the distance with guys? And I know that, you know, Seferino was the, you know, California State, New York State middleweight champion, and, you know, so it's the, but the welterweight went up and went the distance with him, you know, and Seferino Garcia was a good fighter. Nothing's like crazy special though. Sugar Ray Leonard. I mean, if you're shitting on this fight, then when Marvin Hagler, and I know people wanted that Hagler-Leonard fight so bad, but they wanted it years and years earlier, right? But when it was made, no one was shitting on that fight. And that was Sugar Ray coming out of a 3-year retirement and taking on a guy people say is, you know, just no, you can't even dare put their names, Golovkin and Hagler, in the same sentence, or you're catching hell. Well, this dude come out of a 3-year hiatus and beat him. All right, now I'm not saying Sugar Ray Leonard is definitely a much better fighter than Kell Brook, but the point is, Brook, while in his prime and active, you know, finally getting to fight at his natural weight class, even though I would say probably like 54 is his natural weight class, but he'll be coming in at his natural fighting weight, like whatever he even would be fighting at 54, he's going to enter the ring for this fight weighing the same. And Triple G is not a big middleweight, so the weight discrepancy really ain't going to be anything. I'm sorry, I would think that a sharp, active, prime, you know, in his peak, Kell Brook is better than a Sugar Ray Leonard coming off a 3-year layoff. You know, I don't care, like, he ruffled the feathers of whoever it wants. I'm not saying Brook is a better fighter than Leonard, I do not think that, but Leonard, after not boxing for 3 fucking years? Come on, man. You know, we've seen what that's done to fight, like, every fighter, you know, that's had to take years off. You know, they never come back the same. And, you know, Sugar Ray wasn't the same. But he was still able to beat Hagler. The almighty Hagler. You know, so don't tell me that Brook can't win this fight. You know, are more people, is Brook the underdog? Hell yeah. Hell yeah. But who isn't going to be an underdog versus Triple G? Honest to God, who isn't? You know, you have to go to 175 pounds to find someone who wouldn't be an underdog. You know, that's crazy. So, yeah, everyone's going to be an underdog. Hagler versus Duran, you know, started at 122. His best, you know, decade damn near was 135. His best run was at 135, right? But then he had jumped up, to welterweight, two divisions, and fought the baddest man in that division, Sugar Ray Leonard, and whooped his ass, you know. And the second fight, like, don't even really matter, because we all know there was something, you know, whatever, that wasn't Duran at his best. And, you know, but the first Duran and Leonard fight, that was both of them at their best. and we saw the outcome, you know? And he jumped right up from 35, whoop, let's get it on. Whooped his ass. So, you know, Roy Jones Jr. jumping up two divisions, beating John Ruiz. And yeah, I get it, John Ruiz ain't much, but I'm just saying, you know, come on. Two divisions, shit ain't much, man. I mean, not if the fighter is good enough. And Kell Brook is a great fighter. He just hasn't been able to prove it yet because guys don't want to get in the ring with him. You know, it's not like, people get to think that Brook is the one avoiding fighters. Everyone knows that he's tried to make fights with many welterweights. They won't fight him. You know, we saw the whole thing with Jesse Vargas, and, you know, they were trying to get that fight made, and Jesse was dicking around. And, you know, Golovkin was trying to fight Eubank. Eubank was dicking around. So, boom, Golovkin Brook got made. And everyone who knows Brook from the UK, like the fighters and the trainers, they've all said that Brook should not be fighting it at welterweight. That when he's like, when he's cutting weight for welterweight, when he's around, you know, 160 pounds, 165 pounds, that he's the best, that's the best they've ever seen him, and that if he would fight at junior middleweight, he'd be the best junior. I can't remember which trainer it was. It wasn't his trainer, but it was a trainer from the UK, said that when he's like around the junior middleweight fight night weight, that he's the greatest junior middleweight that he's ever seen with his own eyes. Is that true? Is that just, you know, boasting about him? Who knows? We're gonna find out. We're gonna find out. But they've been saying that kind of stuff from long before this fight was made, so it ain't like they're just trying to sell this fight. That's been talked about for a year and a half. You know what I mean? So it's not just for this fight. They're just talking about it again to let everyone know, like, nah, Brook is a live dog in this fight. But you had Duran. I was on Duran. You know, goes up, beats the best dude. He was the best 135 pounder. Goes up, beats the best 147 pounder. Eventually, you know, has his little problems. Comes back, wants to make a great run again. Goes in with Hagler. First guy to give Hagler, you know, a big name opponent. Goes 15 rounds with him. All right, 15 rounds with him. I'm sorry, that Duran would never go 15 rounds with Triple G. Never. It's my opinion, but it ain't happening. Like, never. I know he's crafty and all that, and a hell of a fighter, and extremely smart, and, you know, knew how to fight. But he wouldn't go. He wouldn't last the distance at middleweight with Golovkin. No way. No way. I don't think Sugar Ray Leonard that fought Hagler would have beat Triple G. You know, coming off a 3-year layoff and jumping right into the ring with Golovkin. Like, the Golovkin that Brooks is going to be fighting. No. No, I don't think he would have won. I don't. That's my opinion. Now, maybe if he had a few fights, you know, to get his, you know, even though he was pretty sharp. I don't buy the whole, you know, Mugabe beat the prime out of him, and, you know, he wasn't the same after the Mugabe fight. Because if Mugabe's beating the prime out of you, that's actually, like, you're really shitting on Hagler there, because Mugabe was never shit, you know? He had a fucking good little run before Hagler, but everyone he ever fought that was a good name, they beat the shit out of him, basically knocked him out, you know? He wasn't, you know, come on. No. No, and if that's the case, then what the hell, man? Yeah. Has Hagler get his prime beat out of him? No, if anything, maybe Hagler, which is, from what we know, he wasn't taking boxing as serious anymore. However, he did really want that Hagler fight, or the Leonard fight, and got that, the juice, that fucking fight got the juices flowing again. And, you know, he still lost. Still lost. Hearns and Hagler, you know, that fight was, you know, obviously a war, but the reason it turned out that way, and I've told the story before, Manny Stewart told the story, he went downstairs to check, Manny Stewart and his right-hand man went downstairs to check something, this was right before the fight, and Tommy was up in the hotel room with his people and some of his boys, and they were giving one of his buddies, gave him a full leg massage on both legs to get his legs ready for the fight because, you know, the dumbass, you know, lackey that was hanging around thought that, you know, he needed his legs loosened up for this, you know, because he was going to box Hagler. That was never supposed to be a brawl. They knew that Hagler was going to be coming, and they knew they needed to keep him at the end of that jab and try to, you know, keep lining him up. Manny Stewart walked into the room and saw this guy, you know, just massaged his legs, and he said, "Holy fuck, you just threw the fight away, dude. I hope you know you just ruined Tommy's chances of winning his damn fight," because he knew he'd only be able to box for 3-4 rounds, and his legs would be spent. And then he'd have to go to war on gummy legs. So he basically said, "You got about 4 rounds to go in there and knock this motherfucker out before your legs are going to be like jello." And that's how we got that, you know, Leonard Hagler, or Hagler Hearns war. That's how that came about. It was not supposed to be like that. Both guys' game plan wasn't to just go at each other. No, one was going to be the attacker and one was going to be the outboxer. And, you know, obviously, like, it should have been, but it didn't happen that way. Monzon fought welterweights, you know, Emil Griffith moved up, and fought him, in the first fight he got knocked out in, like, the 4th or 5th or 6th round, I can't remember which round exactly, I think it was, like, the 5th, I can't remember, but he rematched him, you know, so, think of that, you know, a middleweight stops a welterweight in the first half of the fight. Then, not long after, and it was like a year later or something, 2 years later, maybe tops, they rematch. Why would anyone want to see that fight after he blew him out? You know, obviously, because people thought Emil could still win. And he went 15 rounds with Monzon in the rematch. And that's Carlos Monzon. All right. And Emil Griffith was no middleweight, like, at all, okay? He just wasn't. He beat guys like, I mean, he beat Dick Tiger, but, you know, that wasn't, you know. He beat Benny Briscoe, but he fought Licata for the NABF middleweight title, lost that one, too. But, you know, he won some decent middleweight fights, but then lost the biggest ones. Jose Napolis also fought Carlos Monzon. He wouldn't come out after the 6th or 7th round. He quit on his stool. He wouldn't come out. I think it was the 7th. He wouldn't come out for, don't quote me, I can't be sure, but I know he wouldn't come out, like, around the 7th round. Anyway, Middleweights have always been fighting welterweights. You know? It's just what it is. You know, a welterweight wants to move up, they move up. You know, especially, you know, I can understand, like, I criticized the Canelo Khan fight because that's a small welterweight going against a fucking, a big middleweight and a chinny small welterweight at that, you know, who's been chinned several times, you know. Yeah, please. Everyone knew it was going to happen. It was just, yeah, he's going to probably box him, and then just Canelo needs to just land one on a jaw, and it's over. I mean, it's like everyone knew what the hell was going to happen to pick that shit. Charlie Burley, you know. I mean, just Sugar Ray Robinson, first of all, started his career as a lightweight, you know. Lightweight, 135. Jumped up two divisions, straight to welterweight, became, he had his, like, first 20 fights at lightweight, jumps up, really it was only one division, but, you know, because there was, you know, goes straight to 47, boom, champion, right? Whenever he decided, no one couldn't get any fights, beat everybody at welterweight, he goes up to middleweight, loses his first fight ever to, Jake LaMotta, who he, you know, beat the shit out of every time after that. But what happens? He becomes the fucking champion for a decade, damn near, you know? Yeah, he would lose here and there, but every time he would lose, he'd beat the guy, you know? Because he would, you know, Robinson would basically train, have a big training camp, get in great shape, and go on, like, these tours, fight a bunch of guys, and as his training wasn't, you know, it would only carry for so many fights, and eventually, he always had it in his contract, you had to run it right back if you beat him, and if they beat him, then he would start, he'd get into training camp again, and that's why he would just dust them. If he actually trained for 8 weeks before every one of those fights, he wouldn't have lost. You know, he wouldn't have. But he didn't fight like that, you know. He would kind of just, you know, train really hard for one camp and then coast off of that until he got beat. And then he would train, beat that guy's ass, and then coast and coast till he got beat. And then beat that guy's ass. And that's how he became, you know, six-time middleweight champion of the world. But it is what it is, you know. Then he goes from middleweight, whole way up to 175, alright, and he was schooling, Maxim, schooling him, you know, yeah, he was using, every drop of energy he fucking could to bank those rounds, and it cost him, but, you know, hey, I mean, think about it. He was, you know, if this was today, he'd be jumping up two divisions every damn time, you know? Oh, 35, jumping up to 47. Oh, 47, jumping up to 60. Oh, 60, jumping up to 75. And, you know, no one was ever like, oh, no one wants to see that fight. You know, no one was ever like, oh, no, we don't want to see Monzon fight Griffith. No one was ever like, oh, we don't want to see B-Hop fight Oscar. We don't want to see B-Hop fight Tito. And there was a much bigger size difference with B-Hop and Tito than there fucking is with this fight, this Golovkin Brook. You know, so quit. People just love to hate on Golovkin. They just love to hate on him. When this very well might be the fight that you love because you might be able to see him lose finally. You know, I mean, shit. And like I've said always, like I've, not always, but I've said before, just relax, guys. You'll see Golovkin lose. He's a come-forward, aggressive fighter. Chance, he's not going to retire early. You know, he'll keep fighting and fighting and fighting, and a big money fight's going to come along someday, and he'll take it, and if, or, you know, just someone he shouldn't lose to, he will, just because he'll get caught coming into something or something, you know, he's aggressive fighter. Aggressive fighters always run into something eventually. Alright? It's gonna happen. You know? The 90% chance it's gonna happen. Come on, just be realistic with the, you know, we know throughout history what happens with those, you know, aggressive fighters, come forward fighters. But, you know, we know the, I just wanted to, you know, just, welterweights fighting middleweights, that's like, that's always been a thing in boxing. I don't know what the fuck this fight is so polarizing for. To some it ain't. Some it's just a fucking great fight. And to some it's just another reason to... What if... I mean, I remember back in the day seeing videos saying when Brooks said he wanted to fight Golovkin. Like, whenever that was, months back. And people instantly made videos, Golovkin's ducking Brook. I remember one channel, one day, put out, Golovkin's ducking Brook. And then another channel said, if Golovkin picks Brook, that's a cherry pick. Or fights Brook, it's a cherry pick. The same channel switched his tune. The same exact day said, Golovkin is ducking Brook. And then said, yeah, if Golovkin fights Brook, it's a cherry pick. The same guy said, he's ducking Brook, but if he fights him, it's a cherry pick. I mean, consistency, fellas, which one is it? Is he ducking him? Because if he's ducking him, he can't be, it can't be a cherry pick, because you only duck someone because you think they'll beat you. And you don't want to lose. Alright? And I put that channel on blast, but I can't remember who it was. I think Maxwell Barrett might remember, and if he does, he can tell me and I'll put it in the comments, but... You know, whoever that guy was, sure as shit better be saying, yeah, great fight, but obviously you don't, because he already did the other one and called it a cherry pick within 24 hours, so, you know, it is what it is, man, you know. But we know the 30-day weights, Brook was like 176, basically like as high as you can get, as high as you can come in on the 30-day weigh-in, Triple G. Oh, as always, 165. Now, you know, 30 days before a fight, in terms of weight, for most, not Triple G, because he's always just 5 pounds off from weight, but for most, so, and basically for Brook, but for most and for Brook for this fight, the 30 days before a fight is, weight-wise, is just shedding all the fat you can and shredding up, all right? That's it. So, you know, he ain't entering the ring in a 176, I'll tell you that right now. He's just not. Because, you know, he's putting on a lot of fuel, eating a lot, keeping his fuel level high so he can train hard as shit. But he'll start to eat extremely low-fat foods, like basically the foods with just the lowest fat you can get, you know, like salads and fish, and, grilled fish and things like that, you know. Grilled chicken and things like that, to where he can just, you know, shred the hell up and lose some weight. Not much muscle mass, but, you know, a little bit of weight. And then fight-wise, you know, the 30 days before a fight, it's basically, you know, sparring, of course. And really getting your best sparring in on those last 30 days before a fight. Game plan, you know, during sparring, working on your game plan, going over it, you know, you're just working over situations in your head with your coach, like if this happens, this is what you do, or these are your options. practice and, you know, scenarios that might happen in the fight, in the gym, with your sparring partners, you know, that way you're ready for everything, you know, just burning that game plan into your head, plus getting the best sparring you can at that point in time, like right now, they're both getting their best sparring in, right now, you know, really perfecting your fundamentals, you know, getting them down just perfectly, whether it's a simple pivot, making sure you do it perfectly, you know, making sure you're throwing your left hook perfectly for the way that guy holds his guard, or, you know, just everything, you know, getting your timing down, you know, speed and power, you know, basically the calibration of speed power you want. I would think Brooke wants good power, but, you know, more speed, you know, so he'll be really working on keeping power while getting as fast as he possibly can, hand and foot, you know, and just speed overall. You know, getting extremely sharp. So, you know, the moment someone, you know, like, throws a jab, you want to be able to instantly, every time you see an opening, bow, you know, every slip is just a boom, boom, and then a counter coming right after it. You know, just getting extremely sharp. And, of course, accuracy. You know, of course, getting your accuracy down, you know, which is done several ways, sparring, mitts, different ways, whatever, you know, obviously working on your defense, but that just goes with sparring and things, and, you know, different scenarios. Now, I think Brooke will have his best chance to beat Golovkin at, like, around, like, somewhere in between 162 to like 166. I don't think he should really come in any higher than that, because I think he'd want to be fast, you know. Maybe, you know, I don't know. It depends really what their game plan is. And with how big he was, it almost makes me think that they might want to just go in there and fight Golovkin. Because let's be realistic, you know, that is how you beat him. You know, you have to go in there, and I've talked about it before, the only way, the game plan to beat him is getting right up in his chest and fighting with him. You have to have power, you have to have a chin, you gotta be able to take a lot of punishment and go to fucking war. I mean, you're not gonna beat him just by running around and trying to reach out and peck him with a jab and outpoint him. He's gonna cut the ring off on you and destroy you. Maybe Brooke will have a mixture of that. I don't know, you know, but Golovkin's best weight, I would think, would be like 168 pounds. I wouldn't want to see him coming in at like 172. And I'm sure they will bring him in under 170. Even though 170, you know, I think he could do fine there. But I think his best weight would be like 168. Just to get him, Golovkin, as fast as he can be, while still being Golovkin, not like, you know, not necessarily cutting any muscle mass, but just being, and he seems, you know, like he has, you know, at the Q&A they just had, you know, he looks pretty damn slim. He don't look bulked up, and he never really is, but he did look, and obviously that's because, you know, he's getting ready to make weight, and he always keeps himself a little lower. So he'll be a little bit bigger than that on fight night, but I don't think much. Now, the interesting part about this is the timing that each guy is going to be facing. You know, it's going to be hard for either one of them to get the other guy's timing down at first. Eventually, one of them will. If not both of them, but, you know, because, look, Golovkin is used to fighting guys who are slower, hand and foot, and just slower all around, than Brook is, right? So this is going to be the fastest guy he really ever fought, which means he's going to be he's going to have to get the time, and the timing's going to be all out of whack at the beginning for him, and it's going to be like, well, how many rounds is it going to take for you to get Brook's timing down? And on the other case, you know, that's going to be a little hard for Golovkin at first. You would think it should be anyway. But now for Brook, he's used to fighting guys who are faster, you know, hand and foot and just all around. He's used to fighting faster guys than Golovkin. And he can get their timing down beautifully. So he's actually going to be fighting one of the slower fighters he's fought in a long time. So he should be able to get Golovkin's timing down fairly quick, you know, because this is going to be the slowest guy he's fought in a while. And if he's getting much quicker guys timing down within a round, then shit, he should have Golovkin's timing down in a round. That'll be interesting to see how that works, you know, because it's going to be more of an issue for Golovkin to get Brook's timing than it is going to be for Brook to get Golovkin's timing down. And, it's going to be, you know, it's going to be a test for Golovkin, for him to be able to, you know, get down the timing of Brook and have sharp defense versus a fast and accurate puncher with a pound-for-pound skill set, you know, because this is by far the most, like, pound-for-pound skill set-wise, most talented fighter he's ever fought. There's no doubt about that. the guy has more tools and can do them better than anyone Golovkin's ever fought. So that's going to be interesting. You know, that's going to be a little test for him, you know, because I think Golovkin really needs to have very sharp defense for them first few rounds to make sure that he doesn't get caught by any, you know, silly shit, just something, go in there too cocky, be like, oh, this guy can't hurt me, he's too small, and then bong, you're out of there, right? And Brook can't go in there too overconfident, thinking I'm going to fight this guy and just go right out there at him and then just get whacked and fucking look like Amir Khan did versus Canelo, you know? It'll be a test for Brook to be able to handle the one-punch power of Golovkin. We don't know if he can handle it. We just don't. And we ain't gonna know till the night of the fucking fight, you know? But if he can handle it as good as, you know, anybody. I mean, I guess as good as, like, a Monroe or a Stevens or an Adama or, you know, Monroe or Lemieux, I don't know. Well, and if he can handle it like those guys, okay, that's good. But then, can he handle a lot of punishment? Because that's what they couldn't handle. You know, Murray couldn't handle the punishment, the overall punishment. Monroe couldn't handle the overall punishment. Lemieux couldn't handle the overall punishment. You know, so that's going to be, you know, the next test or the next question that he's going to have to answer. And that's, you know, if he can't just straight outbox the shit out of Golovkin or knock him out early, then he won't have to ever worry about answering those questions. He'll just have the fight, you know, won that way. But I don't know. That's probably the least likely outcome, is knocking Golovkin out early. So he's going to take some punishment. He's going to. And he's going to have to. I mean, he's going to have to be able to handle it. So I don't know. We'll see if he can. Shit, what else I want to talk about? The jab. All right, jab. Both of these guys have fantastic jabs, right? We all know that. Now, the jab for these guys, for both of them, the jab is, like, keys to victory. It's, like, the number one key to victory for both guys. The number one key to victory, you know. I guess start with Brooke. Brooke needs to have a fast, accurate, you know, I'm talking snappy, bam, jab. He needs to be able to get that jab off first and land it, you know, not just get it out there, but then have it blocked, because then a Golovkin jab's coming right back, and his will probably fucking land, and then he's going to be swarming all over you. So he's kind of going to need to, it's going to be tough to do against Golovkin, but he's going to need to get that jab off first, land it, then use, you know, lateral movement and an angle, you know, like come over and then boom, so this way and then boom, jab again, come in with like a two or three piece, same thing. Keep turning them and, you know, going back different ways. Like if he comes in, they're lining up, he hits him with the jab, steps over, jabs him again, comes over the top, left hooks him, jump back, and then that, you'd probably be like, oh, that's probably the stupidest thing in the world to do with Golovkin, and it is, but hurry up and get that jab off again, and then come back over here. Remember how Golovkin was using that jab just constantly versus Lemieux? Brooke's gonna kind of have to do that too. I don't know if he can, because that was like, you know, the fucking best middleweight jab we've ever seen, period, you know, since CompuBox anyway. I mean, it was just ridiculous. But he's got to have to do something like that, where he's just constantly being able to put that stick to Golovkin's face. You know, it sure didn't help Gil. I mean, and I'm not talking about when it was his jab. I mean, he threw a right hand and Golovkin just came right back with his own power shot and knocked him the fuck out. So, and I'm sure Gil's right hand hits harder than Brooke's jab. So you never know. He might land a jab and Golovkin just goes, who cares? Bong! And takes him right out. But, you know, he needs to really use that lateral movement and never go straight back for more than just like a step and then hit a new angle, because you don't go straight back versus Golovkin. It's a wrap. And you don't really run around like Macklin did, you know, because you're going to expend every drop of energy you have. He'll just remain very calm, wait for your, you know, your nervous energy and everything to kind of burn you out, and then just slaughter you, you know. So Brooke's going to have to come in here extremely confident, know what he got to do, and do it. Now, I don't know how smart it would be if their game plan is. I did hear Brooke's coach saying, you never go backwards against Golovkin. But I did hear him say they got to use lateral movement, which I think is smarter, because I don't think they're going to want to just stand right there and bang with this guy and say, hey, let's see who lands the first big one, and that'll be who wins. Because we saw, you know, I do not think Brooke hits as hard as David Lemieux. No way in hell. And he cracked Golovkin with a few of his best left hooks. Pretty clean, too. And all it did was piss Golovkin off, and he just charged right at him and then beat the shit out of him even worse. So I hope they take from that you ain't hurting this guy with just one punch. And that was even like fifth round, you know, whatever. So it wasn't like he was extremely fresh. But, you know, I just think that's a bad idea. Now, if he was fighting like a a big super middleweight who fought like Brook. You know, if Brook was a big super middleweight, like if there was such a thing as a guy like Brook as a super middleweight, he would be able to do it. You know, someone like that, but that person don't exist, so, you know, whatever. But Triple G needs to do the same thing. Needs to get that jab off first and land it and keep pumping that shit just like he always does. You know, work everything off of that jab. The jab's always key with Golovkin. You know, it is. He everything just comes off of it. And it's like a power punch, so, you know, it really busts motherfuckers' faces up and hurts them bad. So, you know, it's not only good for just getting your range, but it's good for and scoring points, but it's good for hurting your opponent. But yeah, he needs to get that jab off first, land it, then, you know, hurry up, take a step forward, a little half step forward, get in range, and rip them hard shots while keeping a tight defense. Because you don't want, Brook is extremely fast and very accurate, you know. And if Golovkin comes in, you know, throws the jab and then goes to throw one of these big left hooks he throws, you know, man, Brook could just be like, wham, and just deliver something right to the chin, you know, like a little 45, wow. Who knows if Golovkin could handle it, who knows, because that's going to be the fastest, hardest punch, not the hardest, but, you know, the fastest punch, like the, how can I mean this, not the hardest overall, like the hardest, like thudding, but it's going to be the hardest speedy punch he's ever taken, right? And speed kills, like, even speed creates power, you know? It's common physics, so, you know, yeah, speed plus mass equals force, so, you know. And he can definitely throw faster than anybody Golovkin's ever fought, and I think he's more accurate than anyone Golovkin's ever fought. So he would be able to place something like right there, fast as hell, accurate as shit, and powerful. And that could be the, you know, night-night for Golovkin. But, so Golovkin got to keep that, keep his D very tight, you know, and be wary of that. Keep his guard up, ready to block it, boom, or, you know, kind of get in there and, like, jab and maybe even hit an angle. You know, jab, hit an angle, get down low, and then explode up. Never just jab and then boom, you know. Always give them something, you know, to think about and before you throw that big, hard shot. Or, you know, jab, crouch over, so you're protected down here and you got your chin tucked here, rip to the body, and then immediately come up, boom, and rip up top. That would be a great way to deliver that left hook up top while keeping yourself protected. But I'm sure they're working all this out with sparring partners who are very fast and technically sound, you know, because Brook is a glut. You know, we were talking about this. I remember talking about this with, like, well, with DeGale. You can never really find anyone that fights like DeGale. So whenever you're fighting him, you're kind of fucked in terms of sparring partners. You can get guys to emulate him, but they'll never be able to do it even half as good as he can. Golovkin, you'll never be able to find someone to emulate him. Brook, it's tough to find someone to emulate him, honestly, if it really, really is. But I think you could find guys that just aren't, you know, extremely known yet that could emulate Brook better than anybody could emulate Triple G. So I think in terms of that, you know, Golovkin has a slight edge. But it's still going to be difficult because you're never going to get anyone to emulate Brook even 75% of what he can do. They're never even going to be able to be 75% of Brook. You're really not going to know what Brook is until you get in the ring with him. And especially given that they have never even seen what this guy looks like at middleweight yet. The guys over in the UK have. And they know how good he is, and they've always talked about it, you know. So it's going to be really interesting, man. And, you know, I know if Golovkin, like, just beats the living shit out of him and makes it look super easy, they're going to be like, yeah, I told you this is a fucking mismatch, blah, 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 blah. But what that really is saying is Golovkin's a fucking animal. It ain't that it was some stupid mismatch. No, it means he's a fucking animal. Because I think, and I've said it before, I think before this fight, you know, and whether it was in a faith of my Facebook group, on a phone with friends, or in videos, I've said it fucking damn near everywhere. I think at 155, Brook would beat Canelo. You know, so if people want to see that Canelo Golovkin fight so bad, why wouldn't you want to see Brook versus Golovkin? When Golovkin, I mean, Brook would likely beat the shit out of Canelo. You know, he ain't a mere fucking con. I'm sorry, he ain't nowhere near a mere. He's way better. And especially fighting at 155, yeah, I think he would dog. I think he would dog him. I think he would dog Canelo. And I don't think Brooks should ever fight at 47 again. I'd like for him to, but killing himself like that, I want to see him at his best. You know, if he wins, he needs to stay the fuck at 160, obviously. But if he loses, he needs to go down to 54. I mean, and get fights with, you know, Lara and Andrade. And I love how Andrade just punked Lara on fucking Twitter. Send him a message for that. I want to see him fight all those guys. You know, like J-Rock and, you know, Martirosian and Lara and Andrade. I want to see him fight all those guys, man, at 54. I think that's his division, you know. And obviously, you wouldn't have a belt there, and it might be hard to get one of them guys to fight him there, but it'll be easier to get one of those guys to fight him than it would be one of the 147-pound guys to fight him, because they know they ain't beating him. You know, you gotta have a warrior like a Sean Porter or a Tim Bradley that'll fight anybody that will fight him. You know, Cotto versus Brook at 154. I think Brook beats his ass, you know, all day, like all day long. So, like, people are really sleeping on Brook. I've been high on Brook forever, and I remember getting chewed out in the comment section, like, what the fuck do you see with this Brook guy? Why you keep fucking talking about Brook? And yeah, so I like this fight because I've been talking about this dude forever, and like, this dude's a fucking beast. You guys just haven't, you don't know what the fuck you're looking at or something. Or maybe it was Amir Khan fans that were saying that shit to me just because they fucking hate him. I don't know. I don't know who the people were that were saying it. They're not, like, necessarily regular commenters that I knew and, you know, but every once in a while people would come in and be like, I don't know why the fuck you're so, you know, you give this Brook dude so many props, but I see a lot of fucking talent in this dude, and that's at 47. When he's at like 70% of his best, you know, so I can only imagine what he's going to be able to do at 54. And fighting Golovkin at 160, I mean, Golovkin enters the ring smaller than most 154-pounders enter the ring. Honestly. So, you know, he's basically, you know, if his bone structure wasn't so big and he had more muscle mass, but his bones were a little bit smaller, he could make 54 really easy. But he got big bones, and you can't cut weight, you know, you can't cut water weight out of bone. So it's kind of like Kovalev's situation. He's big bones, but really no muscle mass, you know. Canelo, on the other hand, is just big muscle mass, you know. So he can cut a lot of fucking weight. Julio Cesar Chavez Jr. is working with Memo Heredia now. I fucking hate Memo, man. I've lost so much respect for Freddie Roach. Because Beltran is working with Memo too. I mean, what the fuck is wrong with Freddie, man? I've talked about that before. No boxing coach should allow that guy near their motherfucking gym or their fighters. Like, oh, you want to work with him? Can't train you then. Get the fuck out. And if he walks in your gym, security should beat the shit out of him and throw him down the fucking steps. Honestly. That's sad. But yeah. You know, I guess we'll see an extremely ripped Julio Cesar Chavez Jr. coming back shortly. You know, he'll finally have a six-pack, be all shredded up, and, you know, thanks to, you know, PEDs, obviously, you know, because, you know, we all know that's the only reason you call the guy, and he said that himself. Anyway. Oh, one other thing. I always talked about this. You know, Golovkin fighting to the level of his opponent. And I always said this before the Lemieux fight. Once they put this guy in a very important fight, you are going to see something from Golovkin you ain't never seen. Like, you're going to see him take it to a whole nother level. And guess what? We did. We saw him demonstrate the sweet science better than anybody could have ever fucking imagined. You know, I mean, I knew he could because I was saying it all along. But the thing is, now we got Brook, another extremely talented guy, and he's obviously looking at this fight as the most important fight of his fucking life, and quite frankly, if not the best, one of the best fighters he's ever fought. And we might see something very special from Golovkin again in this performance. And I love the fact that it's a daytime fight. I do. Then we got, you know, Chocolito Cuadras at night. And the Soto Carras Kamagai rematch also. I'll have my man BT covering that for Thunderdome. He'll be there. But yeah, you know, it's going to be, September 10th, right? Yeah. Great day for boxing. I love afternoon fights, like big fights in the afternoon. I love it. And then we got two really good fights late at night, too. So that's really cool, really cool. But I'm thinking, you know, obviously I am, I'm going with, Triple G, obviously, and not because I like him, because I think he will be able to pull it off, but I think that Brook has enough to keep it pretty close for a few rounds there, until, Triple G starts to catch up with him and really start to break him down and beat him up. I don't know if Brook will necessarily win any rounds, take any rounds off of him, but he very well might. But I'd probably say that this fight don't go past 7. No, I don't think it goes past 7. Yeah, no, not at all. I don't think it goes past 7. So I'd pick a 6-round stoppage or a 7th-round stoppage by Triple G. But let me know what y'all think. Thunderdome Boxing Talk. Peace.